A very good morning to you and many thanks for staying with us at 6:30 p.m. quite early, and we're right here to start your day in style. Happy new month, and we definitely want to take a look at the latest developments. It has been a busy January going into February. If January is anything to go by, well, it will be busier than usual. We just want to take a look at the latest in terms of politics, all this centered around the clamor for the Building Bridges Initiative right now, preferably the Constitutional Amendment Bill. Joining me in studio still, Arthur Odera, who's a former legislator for Teso North constituency. Many thanks for your patience and your time, sir. And I'm also joined by Victor Mutuma, who's the leader of majority for Meru County Assembly. Many thanks for your time and welcome to Morning Express.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Now, it would be proper to start on the latest developments around the clamor for the BBI drive, even as it took a notch higher. The Central Kenya leaders met in Sagana over the weekend, President Uhuru Kenyatta leading that particular meeting. He took a conciliatory tone, actually urging the leaders to support the BBI. Let's just take a look at some of the sentiments that were mentioned during that particular meeting over the weekend.
We want to continue to ensure that this work that we are trying to achieve, ya kuhakikisha vijana wanaweza get online work, and they are able to market their goods online, right? So that they have the whole world as their market, continues. We want to make sure that our trade deals that we are trying to tie up with the United Kingdom, with the United States, with Africa, is ongoing. Ili kuja hapa kutuambia hapa wilbaro ni kuja tuwa chukua. What is the way, what policy is that? Ni nini? Kurudisha watu, huko kwa mababu zetu wakati walikuwa nasukuma wilbaro za wazungu.
Well, interesting sentiments right there, even as President Uhuru Kenyatta was meeting a certain group of youth leaders from the central region. And I'd like to begin on that particular point. Arthur Odera, even as we appreciate what the president said on the front page, it seems to be a fight for the youth. And the battle lines are drawn. What do you make of that sentiment, bearing in mind what the BBI has in terms of goodies for the youth?
I think the context has to be set. The president has had 8 years to bring his agenda for the youth to life. And the feeling among most youth is that they haven't got what they were promised in the Jubilee government. And therefore, that should be a starting point. If we are being serious and if we are thinking about posterity, that should be an important starting point. However, the scramble for youth is now about the youth vote in 2022. And that's the sad part of it, because the scramble for the youth of Kenya must be a scramble to bring the youth agenda, the things that bedevil youth development, youth enterprise, youth growth, must be brought to the fore, brought into the agenda, brought into the policy and planning, and brought into the budget of the Republic of Kenya. Mm-hmm. Only then shall the youth feel that they are being taken care of, they are being taken seriously, and they are being taken for what they are, which is an important segment of society and a representation of the future of Kenya.
All right, that's quite to the point. Mm-hmm. Allow me to bring in Mheshimiwa Victor Karithi right now. It will be interesting to note your sentiments about the youth, but let me take you back to some of the issues that came up during that particular meeting in Sagana. The MCAs were quite vocal about a couple of issues even before the clamor for the BBI support took center stage. The 2 million shilling car grant, Mheshimiwa, talk to us about that.
Thank you very much. It's indeed important to note that the car grant issue has been there for quite some time. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't come to me as a surprise that it's getting all this attention. But what nearly bothers me is the interpretation that it's getting from the members of parliament who've been enjoying this for many, many years. Mm-hmm. And the question then begs, I would beg to ask, is who amongst the members of parliament, senators and the MCAs actually deserve the car grant? So it bothers many MCAs across the country that many MPs or some MPs appear too negative about the car grant issue. It's been long overdue. It shouldn't have much to do with the BBI, in my opinion, because it is something that is warranted by the members of the County Assembly, in my view.
Okay, okay. Now that's interesting. Even as you talk about that, the MCAs unanimously seemed to come out in support of the Constitutional Referendum Bill, better known as the BBI. Perhaps give us a little bit of insight into what happened so you could come up with that particular result as a unit.
One thing that I would want to emphasize is, during the Sagana meeting, His Excellency the President took a lot of time to try and link the BBI issue with the 2021 politics. And most of the MCAs have been very concerned about that, because they've been seeing supporting BBI as synonymous to supporting, say, Honorable former Prime Minister, or opposing the Deputy President. And therefore, the moment the MCAs really got the reassurance from none other than His Excellency the President that the BBI is purely based on posterity, then, you know, things started changing. Mm-hmm. And it would be worth noting that many of us, including myself, were really against the BBI initially, before certain provisions were included in the current version. Because initially, we weren't sure whether members of County Assembly would serve as CCs in subsequent governments, county governments. It wasn't very clear that the Senate was getting strengthened. It wasn't, the 35% issue wasn't properly clarified, among other things. So, by and large, the document known as BBI, mm-hmm. in our view, is not particularly, is not a bad document, only that it has been politicized and made to appear like it's meant to focus on 2022 elections, which shouldn't be the case. We need to look at it beyond 2022. And what we agreed as members of the County Assembly of the Mount Kenya region particularly, is to shelve the issues of 2022, focus on BBI. Once the BBI is out of the way, we can now sit down as a region and ask ourselves very serious questions.
Okay.
You know, where our interests taken care of. And that was the main reason for us meeting.
Okay, now that's proper. Arthur Dera, it's quite clear that the supporters or the proponents of the BBI have the work cut out for them. Central Kenya, perhaps 10 counties, Western, perhaps around 6, a majority of 24, in order for it to go to the next process. But basically, this is all about resources, and you know how the clamor for this is quite important in this country. Talk to us about this going forward. How exactly shall this constitutional drive pan out? Is it about the resources, or will we see politics, just as the MC has mentioned, because it has been politicized for quite some time?
Well, I like what Victor has said, that now the MCAs, because that's the first port of call for the bill once it's released by IEBC, and now it's been submitted to the counties for consideration and hopefully approval according to the drafters of it and the promoters of it. Now, BBI is a raft, as it is now, is a raft of proposals for change of law. To change the law, to provide an environment that is seen by the promoters of BBI as bettering the country, bettering cohesion in the country, and bettering the lives of especially the youth in Kenya. What has happened to BBI from 2018 to now is that a group that felt that this BBI is not going to be crafted in our interest went ahead of everybody else, mm-hmm. sowed a toxic environment against BBI even before they themselves knew what was coming. They just created an environment where people say, you know what, there is a beast that is coming to devour you called BBI. Watch out, run away from it, fight it, destroy it when it comes. And I have a lot of conversations with people who are opposed to BBI, and then I want to delve into the discussion, say, wait a minute, but tell me what you don't like. Say, no, it's about the big men, the rich men, and their cohorts, and they want to take care of themselves, they don't want to take it. Have you thought about the 35% to the counties, to the wards? Have you thought about the tax breaks for the youth? Have you thought about how this is going to create an environment where everybody is politically and economically empowered down to the grassroots to set their priorities and implement them the way they see it for themselves? Have you thought that this BBI, this 35% provision especially, is going to make it less important who becomes president, so that even if you come from a minority community that has no realistic hope of presenting a president, mm-hmm. you can still get your share of national resources and do what you need done in development terms right down at the ward level. Have you thought about that? And at that point, it becomes a sober argument. You can then delve into the issue. And I think the promoters of BBI, that's what the president, I think, did to a large extent,
yes.
because I was told that before the president and his entourage came, there was a lawyer who educated the MCAs and educated the youth and educated everybody else who attended the other meetings about this. This is the reality. Mm-hmm. This is what is BBI. And here is a copy, read for yourself. That is what we need going forward. So that pass or reject, the issue is people should look at BBI and see it for what it actually is, not for what a section of the country wants to see it for. If we reach a point where Kenyans have understood what is in the BBI, they will be able to make a decision. And democracy demands that once that decision is made, it will go either way. But personally, I think we are missing a trick by arguing politically and linking BBI to Raila Odinga, uh-huh. linking it to 2022, linking it to the Wilbaro narrative. In the course of that, we obscure the real issues. We obscure the truth. We obscure an objective analysis of what BBI really is.
Well, it's proper that you brought in the policy issue, because, Victor, I assume you have your work cut out for you, because it's not just about the members of County Assembly, but talk of a polarized ground in the Central Kenya region does not make your work any easier. So tell me this. Despite the political rhetoric still going on, how do you sell the fact that, you know, the Ward Development Fund will benefit you, that 35% to counties will work in your benefit, apo mashinani, down to the common mwananchi, yet right now the perception might be that this is to benefit those in power, to divide seats. Well, how do you make this out?
Thank you. I clearly admit that it's quite a task, because of the polarization that has been there, the negativity that has surrounded BBI for a while now, trying to equate it to 2022 and that kind of stuff. So it will take a lot of civic education. We need to sit down with religious leaders. We need to sit down with the grassroots leaders and actually explain to them why the Ward Fund is important for them, not for Uhuru Kenyatta, not for Raila Odinga, not for, Ruto and the others, because we've had a serious problem in our counties, at least for Meru. The current governor, Kirait Morongi, has had something equivalent to what we are now about to get, the mm-hmm. One Fund, but it isn't anchored in any law. So the moment the people at the grassroots realize that regardless of who becomes the president, they are assured of something at the grassroots,
yeah.
then that makes a whole difference, because I don't completely understand why somebody would think 35% going to Tana River County or any other county has anything much to do with the big people at the top. I don't get it.
Okay.
So it's really important for everybody who means well for this country to focus on anything that empowers the people, mashinani. And mark you, the 35% that we are talking about is partly supposed to generate, you know, to help the economy recover, have more industries created at the county levels, and therefore creating more jobs, rather than holding a lot of monies at the national level and denying the people at mashinani the right to services. Because, you know, Jefferson, I would want to let Kenyans know that most of the development that they have experienced mashinani can be attributable to the devolved governments that, you know, we got through the current constitution, and we are enhancing it further through the BBI process. So I completely don't get it, especially for any MCA anywhere in the country, whether they're in support of the deputy president to become the president, whether they're in support of the former prime minister to become the president, or any other candidate for that matter.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
I have to ask you, and sorry, because politics does play out in this in this deliberations. Are you supporting BBI because of the car grants? Or why exactly is this? Because a couple of members of county assembly might argue that devolution, yes, it's brought fruits to the counties, but implementing has been an issue. The current constitution doesn't say just cap it at 15%. It can go even higher right now. How do you come back when people are arguing this way in terms of countering, in terms of differing arguments?
Okay, I started by saying that initially I had some reservations towards the BBI. I talked about timing, I talked about certain issues that were not addressed in the initial version. But the timing to me now, particularly in regards to COVID, things seems to be easing out, at least if what I'm seeing on the streets is anything to go by. And the figures that we're receiving from the government is anything to go by. So I would say those concerns have largely been addressed. The current constitution talks about 15%, a minimum of 15%. It would take serious goodwill for any president to take it to 35% if it were to be left at 15%.
Yeah.
So my argument is, if we make it to a minimum of 35% and create that one fund, then even if we got a rogue president, God forbid, we would at least be assured of that, even if it came delayed, because one of the arguments I've seen, you know, with some members, you know, some vocal members of parliament and some other politicians,
all right,
is that if we are getting delays in getting 15%, where will the 35% come from?
Okay.
I would rather we have a delay of 35% than a delay of, you know, 15%. And who tells you that the economy will continuously do bad? We need to think positively about what is ahead of us. We won't have COVID forever. There is a vaccine. The economy is going to improve. So it's important for everybody to realize that the moment we have stronger counties, the moment we have a devolution that is properly supported, we won't care as much as we do now about who is at the top of the system, of the government,
all
the
right
presidency.
Okay, so we definitely need to strengthen the systems. And even as we appreciate what you've just mentioned, I just want to rebound on what you had to say earlier on, right after that particular Sagana meeting, as we continue with this particular conversation. Just listen in.
Yeah, our support for the BBI proposals, in view of its numerous benefits for the country and our region, we commit to fast-track public participation and a debate on the bill with a view to passing it within the shortest time possible. As members of the county assemblies from Mount Kenya, we commit to take up the task
of citizen education to ensure every man, woman, and child understands the contents of the BBI and to deal with the prevailing misinformation around the BBI proposals. We remain firm in our commitment to champion the unity of the region by ensuring all Mount Kenya counties speak with one voice in securing the future of our region as espoused in the BBI.
All right, so some of the resolutions that came out, even as members of parliament, members of county assemblies and leaders in general met in Sagana with President Uhuru Kenyatta. Atho Odera, it's not the first Sagana meeting that has happened, the third one actually, and the place has become quite synonymous with politics in the mountain. I dare ask, was it a game changer? Will this have good benefits for the clamor for constitutional amendment going forward?
Yeah, for the constitutional amendments, certainly, to hear what the MCAs resolved, I'm sure would be very reassuring to the promoters of BBI. And if BBI passes this first stage, it then goes on to the second stage and the third stage, where you take the issues that require wananchi to vote on for them to vote. And so it's a critical stage, because if it were to not pass this stage, and I think that's why the president has dedicated his time to meet with the MCAs of Mount Kenya. And the question has been coming, you know, why meet the MCAs of Mount Kenya? You know what? Okay. President Uhuru Kenyatta would not be president today if he did not have the rock-solid support of Mount Kenya. Therefore, he is a leader of Mount Kenya in his personal political capacity before he becomes president. And go back to the John Michuki declaration. The late John Michuki made a statement before Uhuru became the leader of the Mount Kenya region. And I'm sure that prior to that statement, a lot of discussions must have gone on in the background. And that was just an articulation of what had been discussed and agreed. And the late John Michuki said, you know what, if you want to speak to us, and by us he meant the Mount Kenya region, speak to Uhuru Kenyatta. And from that point on, the ascendancy of Uhuru Kenyatta into now becoming president started in earnest. And here we are. He is president, thanks in a large part to the support of the Mount Kenya region. In any case, when we think about people going back to their ethnic communities to mobilize, to promote something, isn't it a good thing that one can unite their region and bring their voice to the table to speak to other regions and create national unity? Show me another basis for political mobilization in Kenya, if not ethnic. We mobilize and create positive energy within ethnic communities, bring their voices to the table, and that's how you create national unity.
But many argue it might be a double-edged sword, you know. The same politicians might use the same tactic to divide the country, right?
We are happy that they're not doing that at the
Quite
moment.
So. Yeah.
We are happy that the incidents that we saw in Githurai and in Bama are isolated as it is now. We hope, I certainly hope, that the police will take action on those who are seen to incite violence in Githurai and in Bama. We need to nip that in the bud.
True.
We are going towards an electioneering period, and we must not allow lords of violence to reign free. They must be investigated, they must be arrested, and they must be charged in a court of law. We want a peaceful electioneering period. And the president has gone back to Israel. And you know what? We can live in an ivory tower, we can live in utopia, and forget the basics. The basics are this: every single player at the national stage has been rendered an elder or a kingpin or a spokesman of his ethnic community. Show me one who has not. Secondly, Uhuru Kenyatta was elected in Gatundu to be MP. Mwai Kibaki was president when he was MP for Othaya. He was not MP for Nairobi. He was initially MP for... We were better off at independence, when I read the history of what used to happen then, than we are now in terms of ethnic mobilization. Tom Mboya was able to become an MP in Nairobi. Raila Odinga was MP in Lang'ata. But why Lang'ata? Why not Kasarani? Come to that. Why Lang'ata? If you are able to answer that question, you will be going back to the fact that leaders in Kenya today, until we get to a level of political maturity where we identify an ideological or a different form of ethnic mobilization, leaders get their bedrock support from their ethnic communities.
All right.
So long as that energy is channeled positively, it does not need to be a problem.
Okay. Now, Victor, allow me to bring you in here, because the issue of ethnic mobilization has been brought forth. We had the statement by President Uhuru Kenyatta earlier on that was, yes, taken out of context, but he did mention perhaps it is also time. It goes to show the weight in which tribal affairs influence local politics right here. My question is, as we talk about ideologies and what we put on the table, apart from being the tribal kingpin, what say, do you think this talk about wheelbaronomics, about a proper agenda for the youth, about all that, is actually an idea whose time has come? Is it time we should shift away from the tribal perception and perhaps look at what exactly leaders are putting at the table for the youth, for Kenyans in general?
How I hope that we'll get to the day that the ethnic backgrounds wouldn't have a lot of a lot to do with who gets elected, but I'm afraid to confess that we still have a long way before people look at leaders independent of where they come from. I agree that we need to focus a lot of our energies on, you know, looking at issues with as much objectivity as possible and condemn this idea of, you know, appearing to denounce certain communities, trying to demean certain communities, and making them appear like they cannot lead the country or certain regions. So from where I see it, I would want to agree with the president of the need to solidify his base first and then have this spread out to other parts of the country, because anyway, politics is local. You cannot be, as my colleague here said, you cannot be the president or a leader anywhere without having the support of the people around your home.
All right.
And it's also worth noting that because the president is about to get out of office, you know, at least the presidential office, it is important to have a president who is confident, who is comfortable visiting places with a legacy. And if you've no good name in your own backyard, then that would be a tall order.
Okay.
So I expect a lot of these meetings to happen, especially around the Mount Kenya region, you know, so that the president can first of all demonstrate what has happened in the next, in his 10-year presidency, to give people confidence of continuously seeing him as a leader who made an impact during his time, because we expect to see him just like the other presidents who've honorable left their offices when they are young, to continue to enjoy a lot of respect out there. And the respect has to start from his home area. So if he doesn't have control of Mount Kenya politics, then it would be difficult to really have a great name across the country.
Quite so. And we also expect the popularization to go countrywide, not just in these specific regions. But even as we appreciate what was mentioned in terms of the ideology, in terms of support for the contents of the BBI, politics also took center stage. And gentlemen, we cannot run away from this. The passing of the baton and the talk thereafter about the wheelbaronomics and about the ideologies and the policy that should be behind it. We just played a bite earlier on by President Uhuru Kenyatta Carter talking about the youth and the wheelbaronomics agenda and how he is against it. Let's just listen in to what Deputy President William Ruto had to say in regards to the quote-unquote promise that President Uhuru Kenyatta mentioned he only owes Kenyans, no specific individual. Let's listen.
Nakubaliana na rafiki yangu rais wa Kenya ambaye anasema jana ya kwamba hana deni ya mtu na hana deni ya jamii yoyote.
Authoritative, what do you make of that statement?
Clever statement, if you ask me.
Yeah.
Very clever statement. The deputy president has tried very hard, sometimes in a ways that you find, wow. I mean, he has tried not to antagonize the president. He has tried not to say anything that may be construed to mean that he is now fighting the president directly. There may be some of his lieutenants who have said unfortunate things, and I think the Sonko things are particularly nauseating at the national level. I think he needs to tone down and pursue a different path. But the deputy president is saying essentially that I agree with the president, he is right, I don't feel owed by anybody. Now the question is whether that is a position he has taken based on conviction or based on the fact that that is a line that was tried and it failed. That is an important question for us to ask. I think that narrative was prominent around 2018, even parts of 2017, but it didn't seem to find traction. It didn't seem to deliver political value to the deputy president's camp. And therefore, distancing himself from it as he did is one, making the president feel that there is no direct disrespect and there is no contradiction from the deputy president. But I think it's also an indication that the deputy president is adopting a different narrative in regard to his relationship with the president and almost, you know, calling his bluff. In a way, that message also says, you know what, I feel betrayed by you, but it's okay. I'll pursue a different path and I don't need you, in essence. And that is the crux of the matter.
This is interesting. Yeah. Victor Mutuma, before we come to you, let's just listen into yet another bite by, I believe, the deputy president still.
Mimi nataka niseme hivi. Hata ile rais alisema ya kwamba atapata nafasi yake ya miaka kumi na nafasi ya miaka kumi ya William Ruto. Hiyo ni maneno sikumuuliza rais. Na sitaki mtu amsumbue rais kwamba alisema. Hiyo ni maneno ilisemekana wakati huo. Na sisi wote ni watu.
Okay, Victor Mutuma, it's interesting because the Mount Kenya region has become synonymous with the debt repayment, quote unquote. Raila Odinga also did mention earlier on that his goes way back. So if it's talk of debt, it might actually be his first before this other one. So as a Mount Kenya leader, well, where do you sit on this particular issue?
I'm happy that the deputy president acknowledges that, you know, he doesn't need to have any debt paid. His Excellency the President alluded to the fact that, you know, he basically had meetings before the campaigns and there were, you know, general discussions with the community leaders, not particularly one specific individual. And I would say, I mean, politics is politics. Just like a man and woman gets together and they, you know, they do a wedding, they say till death us, till death do us part. Things happen and we see divorces. We've seen divorces in many places. They are not ideal, but they do happen. So I would say as long as the country is peaceful, the deputy president appreciates that, you know, yaliopita sidwele. You know, let's see a reorganization of the 2022 politics, not necessarily based on the previous election arrangements. And my prayer would be, it would be important for Kenyans to be really, really, really objective on who gets to lead the nation. It can be anybody. I mean, it shouldn't be, there should, in my view, there should never be such agreements in future where there is a predetermined winner 10 years before.
All right.
It's, I don't quite get it why, you know, principals would sit together and completely agree that regardless of what happens for 10 years, we will still have you as the succeeder. It shouldn't be the case, because many things, many other leaders could come up who no one knew about, and they exhibit, you know, signs of becoming better leaders than those who are there then. So I would urge our national leaders, even as we get to the next elections, let us not appear to make so serious commitments about future elections.
All right.
Because the politics is very dynamic. A day in politics is a long time.
Quite so, and I'd like to pick on that point. A day in politics is quite a long time. The Standard highlights what has been mentioned just yesterday. In Narok County, the DP reaffirmed what he just mentioned. I haven't asked for Uhuru support, but he also mentioned, I've always defended Jubilee's government track record because I know that together with the president, we owe Kenyans good leadership and development since we were elected jointly. But in a quick response in Vihiga County, Raila did mention that ODM does not have a single cabinet secretary slot or top position in the government where policies are formulated, but it is the DP who is expected to advise the head of state. What kind of an advisor is he? Just asking a question, but it goes to show that he's accusing the deputy president of failing to advise the president accordingly. That's what has been highlighted on page 8 of the Standard. As we listen into a bite right now, Arthur Dera, I'll come back to you. What do you make of these statements right after we play this particular bite?
Nakubaliana na rafiki yangu rais wa Kenya ambaye anasema jana ya kwamba hana deni ya mtu na hana deni ya jamii yoyote. Ile deni moja tu ambayo mimi najua rais Uhuru Kenyatta hako naye, na mimi ni mshirika wa hiyo deni kwa sababu nilichaguliwa na yeye debe moja, ni deni ya kuwaunganisha wa Kenya na kusimamia mambo ya maendeleo ya taifa letu la Kenya.
Well, the Kenyans don't forget, right, Arthur?
I mean, that's a very important discussion, and I think it's going to dominate the headlines for a long time to come. But just one more thing on what we've been discussing. If the position of the president, Uhuru Kenyatta, now is that he will not support the deputy president for president in 2022, from a moral, from a political morality and political hygiene standpoint, what are we going to do with the statements of Yangu Kumi, ya William Ruto Kumi? Mm-hmm. What are we going to do with the statement of, I will be the chief campaigner for William Ruto in 2022? The president needs to make up his mind, and maybe he needs to explain to Kenyans that as a man of his word, as a man of honor, as a man who occupies the office of the president in this great country called Kenya, he needs to explain to Kenyans, I said this, and what happened between then and now for me to change my mind and to do, and he's at liberty to change his mind. We just need to find a way to deal with those statements as a country. But coming to these statements, the reason I say they're going to dominate the headlines is because it is normal in political life for leaders to attempt to take credit to things that have happened, even if they did not do them. So Raila has had influence in government since 2018, if we are realistic. He has had a lot of influence in government, and the deputy president between 2013 and 2017 had huge influence in government, driving a lot of things that happened between then and now. I'm sure the deputy president will be rightfully entitled to take credit for the things that he achieved, or the things that government achieved while he was influential within government. And Raila Odinga will want to be associated with some of those things, and he will not want to be associated with what is seen as the failures of the Jubilee government. And therein lies the dilemma for both of them.
Okay.
The deputy president will want to blame Raila for having messed up Jubilee and messed up government, and in his own words, to made it impossible for Jubilee to achieve its promises for Kenyans. Raila Odinga, on the other hand, will want to blame Jubilee, but he wants to blame the deputy president for any failures that will be seen within the government. Unfortunately, it is very difficult to say the DP failed to do this as government, while Uhuru Kenyatta achieved this as government, and yet there's only one government.
It's an interesting scenario right there. Let's cross over to you, Victor, and we bring it closer home. At the end of the day, Kenyans will definitely demand, you know, service delivery when we're going into the next general election. Even as we appreciate what's happening in the country, let me bring it closer, Meru, in terms of the Miraa issue. If it is not sorted, they will definitely ask for answers from the leaders, you included. So at the end of the day, the promises made, and in terms of delivering, how important will this be in terms of the 2022 succession race, perhaps in the Mount Kenya region, and going forward, the presidential race?
I would want to acknowledge that the Jubilee government has its work cut out clearly, particularly in Meru, where I come from. There are so many promises of projects. There are so many stalled projects that needs fast tracking. And God forbid, if we get to the election date without some of the mega projects that were promised, some roads, some dams. There's a certain big project in my backyard known as Kingiro Water Project, and a lot of these other projects. It will be a tall order for us to really have our hands high when talking about the Jubilee government. Talking about the Miraa issue, Miraa is grown in predominantly the Nyambene region, where I actually come from. And it bothers me and millions of other people who've depended on this crop for ages that the government has not been seen to very actively, you know, try and restore, you know, the market, the international market. We've seen a little movement here and there. Governor Kiraitu has come out a few times, you know, talking about these issues. I've also seen the CS, Peter Munya, also talk about these issues. But it's not gone beyond that. We've seen a lot of resistance from the Somali government. So what we, as the Meru people, don't understand is it that the government of Kenya is completely unable to diplomatically have things sorted, because the livelihood of so many people is at stake. So yes, I would want to encourage the government of the day to focus on, you know, the promises that were made back then. And these promises were not only made by the president, they were also made by the deputy president, because the way we look at things is that these two gentlemen have been more or less like principals, you know, serving almost at equal levels.
Okay.
So it would be difficult to detach any of them. If the government has failed, then we would also have to get a very clear explanation from the deputy president why he shouldn't take part of the blame. Why should the president be blamed alone, and vice versa? So it's an issue that would need to be dealt with before elections, especially in the Mount Kenya region, and more so because a number of members of parliament have appeared to very openly criticize the government that they are in, the Jubilee government, by trying to insinuate that, you know, the deputy president probably he's been supportive and not so much the president. So there are so many issues that needs to be addressed before elections.
We'll definitely see how they're ironed out. We want to take a short break now, but when we come back, it's important to also hear what the divergent views have to say about the Building Bridges initiative. Some have criticized the Sagana State Lodge as a waste of time and funds rather than putting more impetus into civic education, the printing of this booklet and the distribution of it to Kenyans in order to add on civic education. We'll discuss this and much more when we come back from this short break. So do stay with us. You're watching Morning Express.